هيا على الفلاح. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Like my brothers and sisters, before we start, just a couple of things I want to get off my chest. For those of you who know me very well, you can see I'm struggling to smile, which is not usually... I'm being very honest. Wallahi, I'm very depressed. I feel like my wings are broken, my spirit is down. Wallahi, the last 2 weeks have just... So, forgive me, wallahi, if I'm not myself. I don't know, man, wallah, I'm not, yani, to show you just a glimpse as to why I'm so depressed. You know, I only just found out that, wallah, I don't know what it's called, man. That place in Syria. Wallahi, I just found out yesterday that there's big dramas and people are dying. And wallahi, look how out of touch I am, man. Wallahi, I had no idea. Wallah al-Azim, I had no idea. Wallahi, you know, the whole time I've been driving, I'm thinking, where the hell are you, man? Wallah, I actually had no idea, and I'm sure some of you are thinking, how the hell doesn't he have any idea? Wallahi, I really had no idea. So, and plus of the recent events in Sydney, what's been taking place, yani, so, forgive me if I'm not myself, the other thing is, wallahi, I've got nothing planned. I'm just gonna speak my heart, like I always try to do. The other thing is, you know, this whole event, and I was gonna mention this at the end, but I know myself, when I get carried away, I tend to forget, you know. Wallahi, this whole event, my brothers, everything that you're seeing now is because of one brother, man. One brother that cared. Wallahi, I have nothing to do with all of this. Wallahi. One brother that genuinely cared, he gave me a call, he said to me, look, if I do everything, would you just come and do the talks? I said, yeah. And wallahi, uqsim billah, I'm being as honest that, wallahi, I said, yeah, whatever, thinking, Allah, he's not even going to do it, you know? And look, subhanAllah, yani, just to show you the effects, when one person cares, just when one person cares, and he's prepared to go the distance with it, look what takes place, you know? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him. He knows who he is anyway. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him. The other thing is wallahi, I don't know most of you. So if I happen to speak about a topic that is in your life, or I speak about something that you're currently doing, or you're currently wearing, or you're wallahi, I'm not here to insult anyone. I'm not here to run amok on anyone. I'm not here to degrade anyone. Allah knows our intention is to uplift the ummah and give hope to people. And the reason why I'm saying this is, you know, sometimes, like, I'll give a khutbah and some brother comes up to me after, he said, my brother, are you talking about me, bro? Wallahi, and this happens. I said to him, Akhi, what are you on about, bro? He said, yeah, brother. And like, and he's really cut. Yeah, brother, he's speaking about my incident. You know, he's speaking about my life. You know? And let's, yani, sometimes, like, I'll give you exactly what I'm on about. You know, sometimes I might mention taru. Tabi, Akhi, what are you going to do? More than half the boys have got tats. Does that mean that I don't talk about the issue now because wallah, one or two may get upset? And it's not, don't think I'm here to insult anyone or put, wallahi, I don't get paid for this. It's not like, wallah, you know what, I'm not here to claim fame either. Wallahi, I'm here sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that we can make a move. So please, if I touch on, you know, like one time I said brightening with diamond bezels. So one of the brothers had a brightening with diamond bezels. He got upset. Akhi, wallah, it's an example, man. What do we do? I'm not. So please, can we sort of clear that out now? Yani, is that no hard feelings? Bismillah walhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the King, the Master, the Sustainer, the Creator of the seven heavens and the earth, and we send peace and blessings upon His beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, our life in this world is extremely short. Far shorter than what you think. Many of us, we've got hopes and plans and dreams and ambitions. And the truth is, let me be very real with you. Death will come to you. Death will meet you way before you can achieve at least half of your ambitions and your dreams. Nobody is promised tomorrow, nobody. Death will come, it's promised, it comes unannounced. That is the reality, that is the haqq. That's the truth. No one knows when his time is. And my brothers and sisters, the very reason that we've been created, the very reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He put us on this earth is to do what? Why are we here, my brothers? And please, yani, let's just off the bat, whatever I'm gonna say, I'm sure there's differences of opinion, I'm sure other people have other, wallahi, I'm good to everyone, wallahi, good luck to everyone. I'm just sharing my views, yeah? My views, whatever you like, take. Whatever you don't like, I'm not a sheikh, I'm not a alim, I'm not a mufti, I'm nothing. Wallahi, I'm nothing, I'm a zabbal, maha ifrang. You like something I said? Take it, wallahi, it came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't like it, brother, drop it and keep moving. Don't alli, you know? Don't alli. Everyone's got an opinion, you know? So my brothers, why are we here? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create us? Are we here to play games? Be honest, are we here to play games? Why are we here? Wallahi, my brothers, the more I spend time with the youth, I see that, you know, and we always blame the youth. The truth is that the youth is a reflection of what came before them. Everyone's so focused about the youth, and our youth are lost, and our youth are confused, and our youth, Habibi, our youth are lost and confused because you're lost and confused. Because our fathers and mothers were lost and confused. Very easy to stand and point the finger and say, look at them. Look at them, Habibi, your son, your daughter is a reflection of you. It's a reflection of you. How did you spend your time? What are you doing with your life? Your kid is trying to do the exact same thing, maybe through a different path, but the exact same thing. So why are we here, my brothers? Is the purpose of life to get married? Is the purpose of life to wear nice clothes? Is the purpose of my existence to build a big home? Is that why I'm here? Or am I here to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Am I here? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has placed you on this earth for what? For short time. If Allah gives you life, how much is He going to give you? 80 years? 90 years? 100 years? And then what? And then you're going. And then you're going. And then what do you take with you? What do you take? Wallahi, my brothers, this world is so trivial, you have no idea. No idea. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you for a short time to worship Him, to call to Him, to glorify Him, to establish deen in your life. Two things, my opinion, two things. The purpose of your existence on earth is to establish deen in my life and to establish deen on the earth. Simple. Deen in me, and deen in others. That's the purpose of your life. That's why you're here. Wallahi, my brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't care. He doesn't care. Allah doesn't care how much money you have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't care how many cars you drive. Allah doesn't care how, you know, how big your house is, how many bedrooms, whether there's en suites, you know, granite bench tops, bench. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't care. It's all dunya. Al-dunya mal'una wa mal'unun ma fiha. Law kanat ad-dunya ta'dilu 'inda Allah janaha ba'uda ma saka kafiran minha sharbat ma. The Prophet of Allah, he says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this world is so trivial. This world is so pathetic. This world is so cheap in the eyes of Allah. It's so cheap. It's so worthless. He says, if it doesn't, but if this world had any value in the eyes of Allah, Allah would not have had given a single kafir a sip of water to drink. Not a sip of water would He have had given a single kafir. Imagine someone that hates Allah, he hates his prophet, is an enemy of Islam, clear, open enemy. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still gives them, still opens doors upon them. Money, cars, women, palaces, empires, governments, and Allah gives. Why? Because all of it means nothing to Allah. It's worthless. This is not success. And what's sad is you and I, the Muslim, you and I, the ones that have been given deen, the ones that have been given light, the ones that have been given the greatest gift to humanity, The greatest gift is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Quran and the book of. We've left that. We've left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We've left his deen. We've left his way. We've left his sunnah for what? What have we left it for, my brother? What, for this world? For this dunya? For this dunya? Whoever left this world and took anything with him? Whoever left this dunya and took anything with him? Yet we still fall in the same holes. We still make the same mistakes. The night has been cold. Which side are you on? Ask yourself, which side are you on? Are you on Allah's side? Are you on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Are you on his side? Which side are you on? And don't, wallahi, don't fool yourself. Claim, claims, claims, claims. Habibi, everyone talks. If talking was going to allow us to enter into paradise, Habibi, trust me, we're all in Firdaus al-A'la. But you look at the Sahaba and you look at the Prophet, they spoke very little and they did much. Today we speak very much and do very little. Which side are you on? Wallahi, my brothers, every single person is searching for happiness and we're all searching for success. Every human is, Muslim and non-Muslim alike. Everybody wants to be successful. Everybody wants to be happy. Everyone wants to be ahead of the game. Allah has sent you the Prophet. Allah has sent you His book, His Quran, to show you which path is success, to show you which path leads to happiness. And we've left it and turned to what? What have we turned to? What have we turned to? People ask me, Akhi, now why are we suffering? Why are we miserable? Habib, why do you think we're miserable? The Prophet of Allah, he said, I left you on the clear road, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I left you on the clear road. I left you on the clear path. Layluha ka nahariha. It's night. It's like it's day. I left no stone unturned. Look, I ask you by Allah, a man that taught you how to clean yourself in the toilet. Imagine he showed you how to clean. Not just how to clean. What hand to use? What hand to use? You think someone that went through so much detail is going to leave you lost without direction? He showed you exactly a map. He gave you a map. People ask me, Akhi, what do I need deen for? Have you ever heard this? What do I need deen? You know why you need deen? Because deen is your GPS through life. Deen is your GPS through life. If you don't have deen, Habibi, you're a lost soul. You're chasing your whims and your desires. Deen is a GPS. I'm lost, Habibi. I'm lost. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. Deen, GPS. Turn around. Final destination where? Jannah. Fine. Your location, final destination, that's the road. Follow. Follow. But nahna, no. The road is clear. It's there. I can see it. Let me. And everyone thinks he's a doctor and a scholar. Habibi, no, trust me. Go left here. I'll show you a shortcut. Turn right here. Trust me, Anna, I've been here before. And then when he turns right, is this it? Wallah, no, man. I don't know. Wallahi, you know, there used to be a tree. I think they cut the tree. The ukhadba, left and right and U-turn. Habibi, what do you waste your time for? The path is there. The path is clear. Wallahi, my brothers and my sisters, please try to understand this concept. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not looking to be impressed with what you can come up with. You know, sometimes people think that, you know what? That look, I know that that's the path, but I want to impress Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I want to do something else, or I want to do something extra. Allah is not impressed with this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not looking for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear. This is my path. This is my road and this is my prophet. And you will only success if you follow his road. Anything and everything other than his way will lead you to destruction, even if it's under the banner of deen. Yeah, and if I want to create, and this is where this whole topic of bid'ah comes from. If I want to create a new form of worship, it's sincere, it was really for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's out of this form of bid'ah. If the Prophet didn't do it, it's going to lead you to destruction. Why? Because Allah is not looking for inventions. Allah made it very clear. That's the road. That's the path. He was perfection. You follow, you reach success. You don't follow, You come up with your own things, you make lefts and rights, you're going to be destroyed. Very simple. Very simple. So my brothers, in relation to this topic, you know, where are we? Where are the youth? What's happening in our communities? What's going on with the boys? Why have we left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why have we left the way of the Sahaba? For the way of what? What life are we living? What life have, really, what life have we chose? We've become thugs. Thugs. And not gangsters. Someone warned me. He said to me, brother, don't call them gangsters. I said, well, what are you? He said to me, call them pranksters, because that's what they are. You call him a gangster, even though you're, you know, even though you're addressing the issue, but deep down in his heart, he feels like, see? So he acknowledges I'm a gangster. Habibi, you're a prankster, that's what you are. You're a prankster. You choose a life other than the life. And listen, please, please try to understand. Don't think a gangster is someone that gets tattoos and sells drugs. La Habibi, wallahi, there are people with beads and they pray in the masjid and their fathers and they're 60 and 70 years of age and he's a bigger gangster than the gangster on the street. A gangster is someone, you know, sorry, a prankster. A prankster is someone that oppresses. A prankster is someone that leaves the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's a prankster. But my brothers, what have we left? We left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the life of whom? For the life of whom? What are we following? What's happening in our community? What's happening in our community? There's a death on a weekly basis. A death on a weekly basis now. And who's killing who? Don't you understand? When you leave the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, people tell me, brother, look what kafar. Habibi, don't, never mind what kafar are doing to you. Allah himself will destroy you. When you leave the manhaj, when you leave the way, when you leave the path, Allah will destroy you. Never mind what kafar are doing. Allah himself will destroy you through your own actions. Through your own actions. We've left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for who? Let's be honest. For the way of Fir'aun? Is that what we're doing? Whose side are you on? Are you on the Prophet's side or are you on Fir'aun's side? And the youth and my brothers and my sisters, you know, wallahi, I see the love we have for this love. Yani this life, bro, we glorify it so much. Far, did you see? Far, did you hear? Brother, you see what he's driving? Do you see what he's wearing? We love it, brother. What do you love about it? What do you love about it? You choose the life of the prophets, you will have the ending of the prophets. But if you choose the life of Fir'aun, by Allah, you will have the fate and you will have the end of Fir'aun. Muslim or non-Muslim, doesn't matter. You choose the path of Fir'aun, Allah will show you very clearly. You choose that path, you're going to have the ending of Fir'aun. Look at the way we're going out. Look at the way we're going out. If they're not dying by being shot, one of the mashaykh was saying, I heard this with my own ears, one of the mashaykh. He says, I went to visit an old man. He says, I went to visit an old man. The family called him and said, and this old man grew up, again, a gangster is not just a person who, you know, has the image and the Burberry bag. No, Habibi. A gangster is the one that left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's a prankster. So this sheikh was saying, you know, he said, you know, so the family came to see me to go visit an old man. An old man. He said, so when I got there, this old man, all his life, he used to listen to music. All his life. Farid Atrash and Kalthuna and these very famous Egyptian singers, you know. He said, when I got there, the family, yeah, and just before the sheikh came, they said, Ab, the sheikh is coming, right? They were playing Kalthum. What are the Egyptian singers? They were playing for their father who's on his deathbed, he's dying. So the family said, look, out of respect for the sheikh that's coming, how about we turn it off, play some Quran, yeah, just to show the sheikh that there's still some deen in us. So they turned it off, put Quran on, the sheikh came. So the old man from his bedroom started screaming. He said, turn off the Quran and put her back on, for she soothes my soul. She soothes my soul. Turn the Quran off and put it on. She's like, why? It soothes my soul. You choose the life of Fir'aun, you're going to have the fate of Fir'aun. Wallahi, my brothers, our deen is honor. Our deen is azza. It's karama. And the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a life that uplifts humanity, never mind Muslims. It uplifts humanity. We've left that for what? For what? For the life of thugs and pranksters. And it's a false image. Wallahi, my brother, it's a false image. You think that life, yeah, brother, it's hectic. Wallahi, it's rubbish. It's rubbish. I'm telling you, it's not just so much personal experience. Habibi, I've seen, I've mixed, I've dealt with these brothers. I've dealt with their issues. They've spoken to me on one-on-one. Wallahi, it's filth, filth, rubbish, distraction. You have no idea. Don't be fooled by the cars. Don't be fooled by the hectic watches and the clothes and the Burberry and the... Don't be fooled! The promise of Allah in Quran, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا. Facts! Basics! Who speaks the truth, Allah or Tupac? Nah, astaghfirullah, brother, what do you mean? Habibi, no, you be real! You be real! When Tupac is played and those beats are rolling and he's ripping out the lyrics, be real, the heart moves. Yeah, man, yeah, brother, see the way he put it to him? You see this, you see that? But when Allah speaks, it falls on deaf ears. You choose the life of Fir'aun, you have the fate of Fir'aun. How did our mate Tupac die, mashallah? How? How did he die? Allah will show you again and again, all those that stand and follow the path of Fir'aun, Allah destroys them and destroys them by the thing that they take honor in. Has Allah not destroyed them again and again? And still we follow that path. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? He says, whoever stays away from my deen, whoever stays away from my remembrance, whoever stays away from my path, listen, my brothers, listen, facts. Whoever stays away from the deen of Allah, the promise of Allah, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ, for him is a miserable, wretched life. So yes, maybe to your eyes it appears, brother, look at his cars and look at his money and look at this and look at that. But don't you dare think that they're happy, man. Don't you dare think that they're happy. Wallahi, if I could just expose what I know. On the outside, it has this awesome image. But on the inside, it's filth and rubbish. Come and see. Come and see. And the young brothers, you know, we grow up and we start to strive for this. Yeah, man, that's the path I want, brother. You know what I mean? That's the path I want. That's the image I want. Why? Because why? And you know what? We're all guilty with this. Wallahi, even myself. Even myself, I'm guilty. You know why? Because the truth is, whether we admit it or not, especially the religious brothers, we love their life. We glorify their life. We talk more about their life in our own masjid than we do about the lives of the Sahaba and the Prophets. When it's just me and the boys, did you hear? Did you see? Did you? Oh, that's all we do is we talk about them. What they bought and what they sold and what they drive. And then when we see the young brothers doing it, nah, that's not right, man. We love it. Wallahi, we love it. Because we glorify this life. Now our young brothers and our young sisters now, what is it that they want? They want that image. Why? Because that image brings respect. Because that image brings hectic cars. Because that image brings beautiful women and it brings this and it brings that. But you don't see what else it brings also, my brother and my sister. And this is what's sad. We left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We've left our wives. We've left our families. We've left our mothers and our fathers. We've sold anything and everything that's dear and valuable and that actually cares about us. We've sold it. We've sacrificed it. And we chose a life of people who, by Allah, they care nothing about you, man. I see them. I see them. I see the boys when they're hanging out. Habibi, it's all fake from top to bottom. It's dog eat dog world. Wallahi, when one of them gets shot, when one of them gets knocked, you see the excitement in their eyes. Everyone rocks up to the funeral. Lulah, brother. But I'm telling you, most of them, especially when a heavy gets knocked in the area, Habibi, you know why? Whenever there's a heavy in the area, and he's a standover man, usually what happens is, there's a lot of people that want to grow, but they can't grow. Why? Because he's there. And the only way for them to grow, and for them to prosper, and for them to reach the levels that they want, he needs to go. But you can't knock him. Why? Because, you know, whatever it is. I don't want to talk too much because I don't want the brothers to assume I'm speaking about particular families, you know. And I hate that. Don't accuse me of that. But that's the, wallahi, that's their way. That's their system. So you think that these boys care about you, but as soon as you're knocked, you have no idea what doors he opens for them behind closed doors. You have no idea. Yeah, he comes to your janazah, he acts like he cares, he's all upset, and brother, please let me know. But who we deep down? Finally, now I can grow and now I can expand. Do you think that's family? Do you think that's family, my brother, my sister? When you make more money than him, he's filthy, filthy. When you make a move, when you have a contact, it's all about where's he going, what's he doing. Dog eat dog world, cutthroat world. Is this the life you want? You think that these people are friends? My brother, do you honestly think that these people are friends? You know, I used to say to the boys, you know, when you're growing up, you look up to this stuff, you know, and you hear about, you know, oh, did you hear this guy got charged, he's doing time in Habas. Look how shaitan, he glorifies every aspect of their life. Habibi, when was going to jail ever an honorable thing? When? Just explain to me, when was you being in jail, unless you're in jail for the sake of Allah, genuine for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, you've been thrown into jail because you were uplifting the deen, you know, you were standing for la ilaha illallah, then and only then you being in jail is an honorable thing. But other than that, when has there ever been a situation where someone in jail is a glorified thing? When? Now, and look at the way it works. The first time you ever go to prison, you feel like the biggest antar, brother. And look, just the way we talk about it. I knew a brother that did, I don't know how many years. Like, we used to go to school, and then he did, I don't know how many years, and then he came out. Just, the whole attitude, yeah, it burns my soul, bro. We're doing khayyir. As-salamu alaykum. And that. Shoo, brother, you know? How you been? And wallah, brother, I just got out of Habas, you know? Because what does that mean, yani? I know that you just got out of Habas. Yeah, brother, you know what I mean? I did. And then he comes to Atlu, wallahi, akhi, I don't care why you're in Habas. The truth is, you either probably. See, if I talk, then you're going to assume I'm talking about other people. You know what I mean? No, wallahi, I know people that went to Habas because he was stealing from the pizza man. But he's been in there for 5 years. You don't know why he's there. But I did Habas. And then you and I, man. Who is the shahad maha ufrang, huh? And you and I here, wallahi, you and I here, I think what? That these guys in Habas, that they're all big boys and they're all... Habibi, wallahi, I've heard first-hand experiences. Some of the biggest names in the area, deep down when he's inside, wallahi, they cry their nights. They cry their nights, wallahi, they've become junkies inside. Why? He can't bear with it. Habibi, it's all image. So you got a Habas? Honestly, my brothers, please, do you remember your first prison visit? Does anyone here remember their first prison visit? I remember the first time I ever went to visit someone in Habas. Like I was on cloud nine. I felt like Tony Montana, Habibi. Why? Because I was pretty much a good boy. Like, you know, crime was never my thing. We're going to Habas, man. We're going to see what it's like inside. Wallahi, even my persona, you know, like as soon as I got to the... Like, and I don't have dramas with anyone. I got to the Habas. Habibi, relax. But you've come to visit someone. Yeah, but brother, you know I'm visiting? And I remember, you know, our first prison visit, it was the sickest thing in the world, bro. My first Habas visit. Now when he told me Habas visit, Ya Allah, run for your life, run. Why? No one's interested, Habibi. That's the truth of your life. You got a Habas, your mates will come visit you for what? First month, 2 months, Habibi, 1 year, and then what? You know who you're left with? Do you know who you're left with? You're left with those who you sold for that rubbish. Your mother and your father. The one who now, brother, I don't have time for my old man. I'm fretting Sarani this bloke, bro. Now I don't have time for him. But you go, Habibi, you go. Go to prison and see who really cares about you. Go to prison and see who stands by your side. Wallahi, my brothers, in this life, that life, the only people you will ever hurt are those that really care about you the most. And the people that pay the biggest price for your stupidity are those that care for you the most. Your boys will help you out for the first 2-3 months. They'll put money in your buy-up and this, that, and the other. And then at the end, you think, sure, bro. خلفوا أنا ونسي حبيب. Threatening, man. I don't have time for him, brother. And that's the truth. And then who's left there every single Saturday and Sunday? Speak up, bro. Speak up. Who goes to these prison visits? Who's left? Am Ali and Am Ahmad and Am Muhammad. And she's standing there, bro. An old lady that's had to drive for 3 hours. 3 hours she's driving. And standing there and go through one checkpoint and another checkpoint. And have some guy frisk her and touch her. And all this because you thought you were a bad boy on the streets. All this because, brother, you know, now I'm in Habas Khayye. Every week she never fails you. Where's your boys? Where? Wallahi, I know of mothers. They save their pension money. Brother, pension money. She's supposed to be retiring, enjoying her life. Khalas, I'm living out the rest of my days. She saves her pension money. Why? So that she can put it in his buy-up. So that he can buy his tuna and his bread and the rice. Or whatever he needs, you know. His basic needs. We were supposed to be growing up to help them in their old age. And that's half the problem. Wallahi, that's half the problem. The brother's mother and father have been coming to visit him for 5 years. Tell him, brother, what do you want to do when you get out of Habas? Brother, when you get out of Habas, you've been there for 5 years, your mom's been coming every single week. What do you plan on doing? You think it's, brother, I can't wait to run home and kiss my mom's feet and thank her for coming? What do you want to do, brother, when you get out of Habas? Am I allowed to speak the truth or do we want all sugar-coated? He's either going to a brothel, that's really, he's either going to go to a brothel or he's going to go with the boys and rack up and smoke up and, is this your life? He'll do 5 years of Habas. His mum and dad didn't leave him the blink of an eye. Then when he gets out, instead of thanking them and coming home and repenting and changing his way, what does he choose? And that's the life that we glorify. That's the life that we look up to. That's the life that all of the young brothers here now, you know. Far, man, far. Look at this, look at that. Wallahi, my brothers and my sisters, wallahi, this life is rubbish. By Allah, this life, it's rubbish and it's destruction. And wallahi, wallahi, if you choose this life, you will have the fate of Fir'aun and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring you down to the ground. Because the only honor, the only success, the only happiness, the only azza you will ever have in this life is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything else will destroy you. What's so honorable about that life? What? Look at what comes along with it. You know, it's not just a life. It's a whole, Habibi, it's a complete set. It's a complete system. You got to walk a particular way. You have to dress a particular way. You got to wear particular brands. And Shaitan always comes to you and he starts it off nice and cute, you know. And here comes the part where I know some may get offended. But wallahi, I'm mentioning this for the sake of Allah. And wallahi, my brothers, I'm not speaking about the brother that's repented and changed. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins in dunya. You know? But I see young brothers he's aspiring to do. You know, I see them. 13, 14, you know what his dream and his ambition is? It's to get a tat. Habibi, what do you want this for? Why, Habibi? Just tell me, what do you want it for? You know why he wants it deep down. Wallahi, I've sat in gatherings with brothers, beards like this, and we talk. Brother, you know if tats weren't haram, wallah, I'll get this and I'll get that and I'll have this and I'll have that. What's that mean? Wallahi, that's a sign of how much we love it. And it starts off cute. How does it usually start? How does it usually start, tats? His mom's name. It's my sister's name. Some of them are different. Allah. Ya Habibi tal ghiyabak ana Allah. Soldier of Allah. Only God can judge me, bada. Habibi, wallah, he's gonna judge you, have no doubt. And that's how it starts. Did you ever see anyone get one and call it a day? Did anyone ever get one and call it a day? Starts off with mum's name. Then who does it end with, man? The Prophet of Allah, he says in the Sahih Hadith, the Prophet of Allah cursed. You know, the Prophet of Allah didn't curse kuffar. Very rarely ever cursed kuffar. Very rarely. Was always a man of, yani generally speaking, overwhelming forgiveness and letting things go, letting things slide, and da'wah, you know. When Jibreel came down, when the people of Ta'if, when Jibreel came down, he says to my Prophet of Allah, with me is the angels of the mountains, and if you so wish, they will crush the two mountains over the people of Ta'if, those that stoned him and harmed him and pelted him. What did he say? What did the Prophet of Allah say? He said, I wasn't sent for this. I wasn't sent here to destroy people. No, I wasn't sent for this. He said, rather, I ask Allah that from their progeny, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises an ummah for the people of Ta'if who harmed him and stoned him. But when he came to the topic of tattoos, and yes, my sister, yes. Yes, ya Habib Ali, inti ya Ruhi, yes. For the one that plucks her eyebrows, mashallah. Oh, he's not talking about that, is he? For the sister that plucks her... No, I'm not plucking, I'm just cleaning it up. Have you heard those movies? I'm cleaning it up. The Prophet of Allah in the Sahih Hadith, he cursed. The Prophet of Allah, he cursed the one that plucks and the one that does the plucking. And he cursed the one that gets the tattoo and the one that does it for him. Both are cursed. But I want to ask you something. If the curse of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is on you, what hope do you have in life? You're making dua, Ya Allah, open it upon me. And the Prophet of Allah is saying, Ya Allah, destroy them and curse them. Whose dua you think is going to be accepted? And yet we love it. When a brother gets tattoo, wallahi, all of us, our persona. Look at that, man. And you know which ones I love? There's the guy who plays the humble game. And look, I got a tat, but my shirt covers it. But subhanAllah, his shirt always manages to miss the few strokes that come out at the end. And look, I haven't showed you the complete tat, but I want you to know that there's something under it. And there's the brother, and look, I know personally, I know many, many brothers that got tattoos and repented and changed, and wallahi, they are the most of God. Wallahi, they're the most God-fearing people that I know. Some of the most God-fearing. Let's be clear. I'm not speaking about the brother who's pulled up. And some brothers genuinely back in their days got tats in particular places that they can't hide. He really can't hide it, right? But you can see in his character that he's not proud of it. You could see it's in their character. It's in his demeanor. And who is not proud of it? But I still see brothers, so-called religious, and he's supposed to be pulled up and beard and abaya, but he'll always manage to show a taru that really can be covered if he wants it covered. Why? Because we love that. We love it. Is this, wallahi, my brothers, is this what we're after? Have we really left the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for this? Look, look, look at this life. Look at these people and how they live. You know, wallahi, my brother, especially the young brother that's aspiring to be like this. I take an oath by Allah. You know, those that used to be genuine OGs, genuine gangsters, really back in the days. They really used to be genuine pranksters, sorry. Those that really have repented, they're the ones that hate that life the most now. Why? Because they know how filthy it is. They know how filthy it is. And for my young brother, the one that's aspiring to be like that, let me tell you the truth. While you think that this path is glamorous and glorious, wallahi, the whole community thinks you're a nishah. Am I lying? Please, please help these young brothers. Am I lying? Who thinks that this life and that image is disgusting? Raise your hands for the young ones to see so that they don't think I'm lying. So you've seen it with your own eyes. You think that, wallahi, the community is fed up. It's fed up. You know, there used to be a time when we used to hear someone got shot. Ah, who, when, how, what happened? Now, oh Allah, when are these people going to change, bro? And you know what, my brothers? Do you know who ends up shooting most of these people? Do you know who ends up? Who knows? Who ends up knocking most of these people? Who? Their mates! Their mates, their boys, their cowies! Brother, he's my celly. I remember the first time I heard that, because I got no idea .com, yeah? He's my celly. I thought, what's that? Like a cell phone? I really didn't know. What, like, what's a celly? Nah, brother, he was my cellmate. We did habas together. So we go back to the habas part, you know what I mean? How many times, and be honest, how many times have we heard a brother got knocked? A brother got killed by who? By his celly? By one of the boys? And people do this whole, brother, wallah, we're like this and we're like that, and I'll take a bullet of fire, khayye, and ta, oh khobba, a flame handi wa turki ba, bro. And wallah al-azim, I take an oath by Allah. And by no means am I trying to be funny, Allah knows. And wallahi, my brothers, as soon as, and I hate it, brother, this came out, brother. Habibi, when this comes out, he runs. Wallahi, that's the truth. One of the boys got knocked while he was with his mates, and not a single person made a move. Why? Because that's the truth. That's the truth. That's the life you're living. No one for no one. Brother, I'll take a bullet for you. Brother, sit down. Please, man. Take a bullet for you. Just wake up and make dua for me. It's an image, wallahi, it's a false image. And you know what else? You know what burns me the most? We think these people are tough. We think that image is strong. Wallahi, 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 I take an oath by Allah. Wallahi al-azim, they are, most of them, so that I do justice. Most of them are the biggest cowards on the face of the planet. Because you know why? The truth is, we're only strong, we only oppress, we only put it on the one that we know he can't do anything about it. Tell me I'm wrong. When a drama in the area happens, this is generally the go. Generally, I'm not saying all. When a drama takes place, what's the first thing they do? Brother, who's that? Habibi, what does it matter who's that? Aren't you staunch, brother? Aren't you a Zalmikaz? What does it matter who that is? What do you need to ask for? There's a reason why he's asking. Why is he asking? Why? Because if he's a heavy, if he's someone that can do damage, then what? Brother, nah, wallah, for the sake of Allah, I'm forgiving you. For the sake of Allah, you little kazzab. For the sake of Allah, you little kazzab. But if it's someone I know I can hurt him, and I know I can put it on him, and I know that pretty much nothing's going to happen to me, well, we've seen what happens. Is that a real man? Is that a real man? And be honest, who are we killing? Who are we killing? Ever noticed how we're only killing each other? You know why? Because we know each other. Very rarely, and I'm not encouraging this in any way, shape, or form. Very rarely did anyone ever get out of the area and do dramas with someone that's unknown. True or not? Please answer so the young kids know. True or not? Yes, it's true. Why? Brother, madda mao, brother, madda mao. Madda mao, but for me, Trump, Trumbaki, no problems. For him, madda mao. But for me, you do the dapki, no problems, you little jaben. Why? Because I'm daif? Because I don't have a big family? Why? Because I can't stand up for myself? Is this our deen? Is this Islam? The Prophet of Allah and his companions who came to teach us that the strong should look after the weak. Those that are rich should look after the poor, not take advantage of them. The brother goes, opens up a manoor shop. He opens up a little cafe. He's trying to make a living. He's trying to do something halal. He's trying to feed his family. He's trying to stay off the streets and stay off haram. And what do? Instead of helping him and supporting him, we're asking him for protection money. Like a tfa alaik ya nishah. Tfa alaik ya nishah, you're a wati, brother. Wallah al-azim you are. You're a coward. Instead of helping and uplifting and rising your ummah, what are you doing? You come up to the miskin, what's he making a week? 1500 bucks, 2 grand a week. And the brother comes, hits him up for $500 protection money. For what, brother? For what? What's he selling? Za'atar and cheese? But what's he doing? Nah, brother. Nah. Khadba, yeah, you know what? Let's open doors. No, brother. I only do it because he's a Shi'i. What? Is that how you're justifying away because he's a Shi'i or he's a Alawi? Where's your akhlaq? Where's your adab? Where's your trying to call him to deen? Trying to call him to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Trying to save these people? Where? No, brother. He's not one of us. One of who? Yani who? The Prophet of Allah, when a Jew cried, a Jew died. A Jew, ya Allah, a Jew. When he died, the Prophet of Allah, he cried. Sahaba said, the Prophet of Allah, you cry for a Jew? He said, yes, someone left my ummah and I couldn't save him from hellfire. What are we doing? And we love it, bro. Wallahi, we love it. Wallahi, I can talk all night, man. Wallahi, I can reap examples all night. And the sisters, before I forget. Malesh, you're not going anywhere. Relax. And to be fair to them, because not all, they're still, alhamdulillah, there's still a lot of God-fearing sisters who still have modesty and haya. We ask Allah to protect them and to increase them. But we know, generally now, what's happening, and it's starting to flourish. What's happening? What does the sister want? Honestly. Do we want the brother that's trying to change, he's trying to live a simple life? Yeah, he's not the richest guy in the world, he's trying to bring deen to his life. You know, he spends most of his time trying to work for the deen and work for the ummah. Who wants to marry that bloke, man? Everyone wants a what? No, that's not fair. Don't. Honestly, astaghfirullah, wallahi, that's not good at all. No, it's not an example, akhi. That's not right. You know? Because he's a Muslim. We need to protect our brother even if he does wrong, you know? Astaghfirullah. So who do we want? Who do we want? Of course we want brother. I want the brother that's got an, you know, wallahi, because it's not because the sister's evil, you know, because we've been brought up, because we've glamorized this life. She wants the bad boy that can get her a Burberry bag and he can buy her a Coach this and he can buy her this. And that's, and wallahi, and that's what we want. Wallahi, my sister, do you think these women are happy? Wallahi, I know of a particular sister. She's the envy of every woman in her circle. She's the envy of every woman. Car, you look at in magazines. Clothes, only wallahi, only celebrities wear. Handbags and shoes, there's a new one every week. But when she calls me, and her husband's cheating on her and she knows it and she can't do anything about it, or her husband goes out with the boys for 2-3 days and doesn't come home for 2-3 days. Yeah, the image on the outside is very nice and pretty, man. But what's on the inside? What's on the inside? If that's the measuring stick, if dunya, my brothers, my sisters, if the value of your husband, if the quality of your husband is based on the dunya that he gave you, then your beloved Prophet was the worst of husbands to his wives. Am I even allowed to say that? Is that even allowed to say? A'udhu billah, was the Prophet of Allah the worst to his women? He says, the best of you are those that are best to the women, and I'm the best to my women. What dunya did he give her, my sister? What dunya? Aisha says in the authentic narration when she was speaking to her nephew Urwa, she says, wallahi, a full moon, we would see the full moon, then the full moon, then the full moon. 2 complete months used to pass us by. 2 complete months used to pass us by. And she said there would be, she said not a single flame, not a single flame was lit, yani no cooking and no boiling in any of the 9 houses of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, sisters always told me, you know, I wish I could marry the Prophet. Sister, please, 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 for the sake of Allah, please, sit down, man. So Urwa says, he says, oh my auntie, 2 months, how did you people survive? She said to him, al-aswadan, al-tamru wal-wa'am, al-tamru wal-ma'am. She said, we survived off dates and water for 2 months. And then one time, there was some sort of dispute. One time, you know, his women came together and they asked the Prophet of Allah, no, do you think maybe you can increase in our dunya? The Prophet of Allah, one time he seen Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, he seen her eating twice in one day. Twice in one day. What was she eating? Barley bread. And he said to Aisha, I see that you have nothing to do all day but eat. Today there's dramas. Brother, it's been 3 weeks and my husband hasn't taken me to a restaurant. He said to Aisha, I see that you have nothing to do but eat. So one time, Quran, one time, the wives came together and they said, look, yani, we're not asking for palaces, but just yani, maybe if you can increase the living standard a little bit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says to the Prophet of Allah, tell them, tell your wives that if it's this life that they seek, if it's the luxuries of this world that they seek, then tell them to come. We will give them their rights. You will divorce them in an honorable manner. They can go and seek their wealth. But if it is Allah and the Akhirah that they seek, then tell them more or less, tell them that this is the path. Wallahi, my brothers, I can talk all night, you know. But the sisters, wallahi, even, you know, now, you know, I just came back from Umrah, yeah? Just came back from Umrah recently. You know, it's even our deen, even that which is supposed to be beautiful and pure, we inject it with dunya, you know? Have you seen this trend now? Sisters wearing Burberry scarves over their hijabs and over their niqabs and over their... And look, it's not haram, let's be fair and clear, yani, it's not haram. So, but you just, wallahi, you just think, where are you going, bro? What's... You know, the Muslim's supposed to be humble. And anyway, so please, my brothers, choose your path. What do you want? You want Fir'aun? Or do you want his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So how do we draw this to a close now? All right, we've heard, yes, we've had a good laugh. And what do we do? Wallahi, my brothers, we need to change. And look, change, I'm going to be the first one to admit, there's many opinions. But akhi, wallahi, you need to make a move. You need to make a move. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says more or less, he says, I will not change the condition of a people until they change the condition of themselves. Habibi, wallahi, I cannot help you. If you yourself don't want to help yourself. If you yourself are not ready to put your hand up and say, you know what, brother, I need help. I need to make a move. And what are we asking for? Are we asking that we want people to become a sheikh and ulama? No, 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 wallahi, no. But just make a move. Make a positive move. Wallahi, if there's anything you take from here, you know, this has been my message for the last few weeks. I'm begging everyone. Habibi, just start praying. Just start praying. Is that hard? Let's just start praying. And don't let shaitan get the better of you. Because look how shaitan works. Brother, how do you want me to pray and I'm doing bizzo? Brother, how do you want me to pray and I have a girlfriend? Brother, how do you want me to pray and I drink alcohol? Brother, Habibi, what? You know, please, my brothers, help me. How does two wrongs make a right? How? You selling drugs, or you taking drugs, or you... That's one haram, yes or no? Yes. But you not praying, Habibi, that's another world. Don't let shaitan destroy you. Don't let shaitan fool you. Your salah is between you and Allah. Don't let anyone stand between that. So brothers told me, yeah, but brother, I heard that, you know, if you drink alcohol, that you can't pray for 40 days. And you can... I think, brother, where do you get this from? Pray. No matter what you do, my brother and my sister, pray. I'm not encouraging sin. And I'm not encouraging haram in any way, shape or form. But I'm just saying, even if, so please, yani, I hope I'm being clear. Even if, let's say, khalas, I'm determined, today I'm going out clubbing with the boys. That's it. You're not going to stop me. I say, fine. Khalas, if I can't stop you, it's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's fine. But please, my brother, please, before you go clubbing, pray Isha. Is anything wrong with that? Don't be, brother, that's hypocrisy. Brother, you're the hypocrite. Sit down and shut up. Because when you run your mouth like that, you're turning people off deen. Some brothers, in trying to stop a brother from selling drugs, he picks on the only good thing he does. Brother, you pray and you sell drugs, how can that be? So what does the brother end up doing? Yeah, he stops the prayer. You instigated that. Don't assist shaitan on your brother. Don't assist shaitan on your brother and don't assist shaitan on your sister. So what do I say to the boys? Ya Habibi, do you want to go out clubbing? Do you want to drink up and get wasted? That's fine, just pray Isha. Can you do that? And try your best. Be home before Maghrib, be home before Fajr. But our problem is we've become extremists. You know, there's certain people that is, you know, like most non-Muslims, we just like to have a fine dine and wine. Not us, Habibi. If I don't get wasted and trashed and start a brawl on the street, I don't want to drink. We like to smoke a bit of weed. It just, you know, gets things off my mind. Have you seen those ones? Gets things off my mind. Habibi, if I don't up for stuffers, and if I don't start a bizzo and a run and a rakat and a this, I don't want it. Ya Allah. We're always extremes. Bismillah. So please, my brothers, wallahi, come back to your deen. Come back to salah. Come back. Please just come back. Come back and start moving, man. Start moving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's been a long night. There's food. Please no one leave. Wallahi, it's half an hour. We've been out so many times. And wallahi, half an hour for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, it's not going to hurt. I just want to spend a couple of minutes because I don't want to feel like I've wasted my night. I just, like, now that we've spoken, I want to ask the boys, what are some of the intentions that we've got now? Because this is what happens. We come here, we sit, we watch, you either get entertained or you get pumped or you get motivated or you have a laugh. And you go back home and then there's no change in you. We don't want that. We don't want that. I've come, I've heard, I've been inspired. Maybe something's moved you. Now we need to start making intentions. And I want to hear some of your intentions. You don't have to tell me everything, but I want to hear some of your intentions. And there's a reason why I'm doing this. You'll know at the end. Just a couple of minutes, inshallah, and then we'll have dinner. Can we do this? Please, everyone, yeah? Type. Who's ready to raise up his hand after hearing this talk now? Who's ready to start making some changes and some intention in his life? Naam, akhi, what's your intention? You want to change your friends? Tamam. So he's noticed, okay, so the people around me, maybe they're not calling me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, why am I asking? Because my brothers, our intention, you need to take your time. Rome wasn't built in a day. Nahna, we get pumped. You wake up the next morning, you want to establish everything. That's not how it works. It takes time. Who else, inshallah ta'ala? Naam, akhi. So now you want to make sure you pray your five prayers. Okay? What you need to do, my brother, is at least choose one of these prayers and say, Ya Allah, no matter what happens, this particular prayer, I will never leave it. Right? That's your, this particular salah, I will never, ever, ever leave, no matter what happens. Right? So, wallahi, make your intention small, basic, it's achievable. That's what you need to do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept you, akhi. Who else? Naam, brother. So, to look at yourself. Inshallah ta'ala. Who else, inshallah ta'ala, wants to share an intention with me? Naam, brother. Give da'wah to everyone and to yourself, inshallah. So this is the niyyah. It's to give da'wah to ourselves and to everyone, especially our families and those people who are around us. Just one thing. Why am I sharing this? What happens is, my brothers, you usually hear a talk, you get motivated, you get pumped, and you make a big intention. What happens is, this is how shaitan destroys you. What does he do usually? You end up making an intention that's far bigger than what you can actually achieve. Then when you don't achieve it, what does it do? It usually turns you off and you go straight back to your old ways. I'm going to share this last advice and then we'll end so we can all have a feed and get together. Let's say you've agreed that, khalas, after hearing this talk, I've agreed that I'm going to start reading half a page of Quran a day. That's achievable, it's realistic, it's not extreme, half a page of Quran. What you need to do is, with your intention, you need to promise Allah half a page no matter what happens. Then a part of the intention, there needs to be a penalty. What do I mean? Like a parking fine? Not quite, but similar. Yani, when you promise Allah that, Ya Allah, I promise you, as of this day, I'm going to read half a page of Quran a day. And when the day comes that I don't read my half a page, because it will happen, naturally it will happen. When the day comes that I don't read my half a page, then, and I hope you're listening, please listen. Then, Ya Allah, when the day comes that I don't read my half a page, I promise you, Ya Allah, the day after, I'm going to read 2 pages and I'm going to give a certain amount of money in charity. And this amount that you choose has to be enough that it pinches you. Not $3, because I'll just pay the whole year in advance now. Yeah, I don't front you, bro. It has to be an amount that pinches you. Why? Because when the day comes that you don't read your half a page of Quran a day, and you stick to your word, you stick to your promise, and you actually end up reading 2 pages and give the money in charity, I take an oath by Allah, if you stick to this, you know what's going to happen? When the day comes that you actually don't read your half a page of Quran, when shaitan believes the promise you made with Allah, he's going to tell you, Habib al-Bita'ah, he's going to grab you by your hand, take you to the mushaf, and tell you, please read your half a page now, because if you don't, tomorrow you're going to cost me 2 pages and certain amount of money in charity. Allah Ta'ala, like, read the half and I'm happy with it. When there's no penalty, what happens? When there's no red light camera and it's 3 o'clock in the morning and there's no one on the road, what do you do? If you stop, what a gronk. What a mahattar, bro. True? Why? Everyone's a hantar. But wallahi, the biggest mujrim, the biggest prankster on the planet, the guy that's got teardrops from here all the way down to his toes, even at 3 a.m, and he's driving his AMG, and he gets, and there's a traffic camera light, what does he do? Like, he rips a handbrake. Why? Because mashallah, he's such a law-abiding citizen. Why? Yeah, Habibi, that fine. Be the same with your deen. Jazakallahu khairan. Wallah, forgive me for any shortcut.